Теперь работает? Вот, отлично.
Да, мы по-английски должны знать. Окей. So let us continue our last session for today with two talks by so now it will be talk by Сергей Самсонов from High School of Economics and Сережа. So Сережа is a PhD student at HEC. And Сережа will talk about local global MCMC in kernels, actually, about, in some sense about idea of exploration and exploitation phase in sampling. So, Сережа.
Yes, Алексей, thank you. I would talk about the local global MCMC approach, so our recent joint work with Alexey Naumov, with Eric Moulinet, and with other co-authors from HSC and from Ecole Polytechnique. So it is accepted to New RIPS this year. And if time permits, I would also tell a little bit about our another New RIPS paper, also with Eric Moulinet and some guys from Ecole Polytechnique. About another modification of some basic MCMC algorithm, ICIR, that will be like one of the main objects of interest in today's discussion. Okay, so let me start. So, Does it work? No? Да, там вот он-то. Okay, so we aim to solve somehow the sampling problem. So we have some distribution pi in RD. And we are willing either to compute an integral of some function f with respect to distribution pi, or we want to sample from distribution pi directly, for example, then to use later these samples in Bayesian inference or in some other types of applications. So it's very classical problem. So it's not always the case that you can generate independent, identically distributed random variables from pi. For example, this problem can be like explicitly solved, in fact, only for one-dimensional distributions, when you can use different like inverse cumulative distribution function tricks and some other stuff like this. So here we will assume the case when the target distribution is in fact known only up to normalizing constant. And in this case, there are some like standard solutions that one can come up with. So in fact, one of solutions would be to use MCMC methods, that is to construct some Markov chain with the invariant distribution pi, such that this Markov chain would be geometrically, for example, geometrically ergodic. So in some sense, it will forget the initial distribution and the distribution of the nth step of the chain will become very close to the target distribution pi. But for now, suppose that we focus on calculating integrals from pi. And in this case, one of the standard and well-known approaches is the so-called important sampling. So instead of sampling from pi, you have some simple distribution lambda, such that pi, both pi and lambda are absolutely continuous, for example, with respect to Lebesgue measure, so they both have densities. You can generate samples from lambda. So in this case, you multiply and divide by lambda, in fact, under the integral. And you substitute your integral with respect to pi by the following self-normalized quantity. So it is some statistics of samples from lambda, which is reweighted by the ratios of target density pi divided by the density lambda, which we used during sampling. So this is very standard technique. The problem is the following. So in general, if you don't know the normalizing constant of pi, And if you are forced to use the self-normalized version of this procedure, then unfortunately it will be biased. There are some standard results about the bias and variance of these self-normalized estimates. So roughly, they scale inversely proportional to the number of particles that we used in our estimate. And so I think I will skip that slide. So the quantity of interest that appears here, and it will also somehow appear in our analysis, is the second moment of this density ratio, like pi divided by lambda, with respect to the generated distribution lambda. So these are standard bounds, so they are known from literature, so there is perhaps nothing super special about them. So why I told you about them is because, in fact, important sampling gives rise to the one very popular sampling technique, which is so-called iterative sequence importance resampling algorithm. So it goes back to Christoph Andreou. Roughly speaking, it iterates as follows. So I would skip perhaps the preliminary definition. So what you do? Now you want to construct some Markov chain from this relating idea such that its invariant distribution will be pi, and that the Markov kernel of the chain would be somehow ergodic in an appropriate sense. So on every iteration of the algorithm, you do more or less the following. So you draw some samples from lambda, then you compute the same self-normalized weight statistics as you do for the important sampling. And then you sample from categorical distribution, so you choose one particular proposal of the round that you generated at this moment. Then you keep only this proposal, you remove all the other guys, and then you resample once again. So this allows you to construct a Markov chain that will keep pi as invariant distribution, so that's easy to check that indeed the invariant distribution of the procedure will be pi. But there are some problems of this algorithm. In some sense, it is global. So I would somehow later tell what is the difference between local and global MCMC kernels. So here it is clear that our algorithm somehow is constructed such that it affords global move of the support of the target distribution pi, because in fact you just propose new particles according to some pre-specified generating distribution lambda. So you can do very large moves along the support of the distribution, but at the same time, the problem is that you can really get stuck in one particular mode of your distribution, unfortunately, especially if the dimension of the problem is very large. So typically, you will either need to have very large number of particles, capital N, that you use on each iteration, or you will very often reject all particles that you propose. So it's easy to illustrate, so I will do it later. And just a few notions before I proceed. So what people are typically interested in when they prove some theoretical results about Markov chains is the following. So this is the so-called V-uniform geometric ergodicity of the Markov chain. And roughly speaking, this quantizes the speed of convergence of the moments of functions that grow not faster than some fixed V-function. So typically, for example, if we want to have somehow convergence of, say, polynomial moments of the distribution of the n-step iterate of our Markov chain, then you typically want to have like exponential V function or something like this. So what can we say about ergodicity of ICR sampler that I just introduced? So if you know that, if you somehow manage to propose such generating distribution lambda, that's a ratio of the target distribution divided by the generative distribution is bounded, Then you can show that, in fact, you are uniformly ergodic. So you are ergodic even in the sense of the total variation distance. But and you can write the, you can write down the ratio. And I'm not sure that you can easily look at it, you can easily see it. But it shows you that typically the number of iterations, the number of particles that you need to use on each iteration, if you want to have some meaningful rate of convergence, it scales proportionally to the density ratio of the target divided by proposal, which is, of course, very bad, because this density ratio, it can be exponentially large, exponentially with dimension. For example, you can imagine the pathologically bad case when you have just distribution with independent marginals. In this case, this normalizing constant will increase with dimension as some constant to the power d, which is very bad. And I will now show you, yeah. So this can be illustrated. So this is the case. So this is a part of some trajectory that is generated with ICR algorithm from one of the generative models trained on CIFAR-10. So as you see, this is really how the typical trajectory obtained with ICR algorithm looks. So you generate some object, and then for quite large number of consecutive steps, you are really stuck in this object, so you don't generate anything new just because you reject all potential moves proposed by the algorithm. And that's why you perhaps have an idea that you can change something in this algorithm in order both to speed up the convergence, perhaps, and to improve the practical performance. Yep. So, okay, so something is missing on the slide. So we will aim to somehow combine the local and global MCMC kernels in our paper. That is, we will build some improvements on top of this global MCMC kernel ICR. So there are well-known local MCMC algorithms. Typically, they are based, for example, on the discretized Langevin diffusion, or they are some algorithms of type of Hamiltonian Monte Carlo or something like this. These methods, they focus on local exploration steps over the support of distribution. They allow for very good exploration of one particular mode of the distribution. At the same time, especially in large dimensions, they have problems with mixing time, which becomes super large. And we want to somehow overcome the problem of the both algorithms just by suggesting some combination of them, in fact. So the idea of the local global sampler, in fact, is very simple. So you just combine the two Markov kernels, one which corresponds to some global moves over the distribution support, and one which corresponds to local moves, for example, to something in practice you will take most likely some diffusion-based sampler or Hamiltonian Monte Carlo, something like this. So compared to ICR, the algorithm is very simple. So after you applied one step of ICR, you just apply, for example, one or some consecutive number of local MCMC samplers, for example, based on Langevin dynamics. And what is interesting, so I will perhaps skip the slide with some theoretical guarantees for the method, but I will just tell a few words about them. So in general, it is interesting that particularly for ICR, we are able to prove the V-uniform geometric ergodicity of our sampler under the conditions which are milder than the assumptions that that are required for the ICR kernel alone to be V-uniform geometrically ergodic. Because in general, we take the composition of two Markov kernels, and our technical assumptions, they say that only the second one of them is V-uniformly geometrically ergodic, and for the first one, we just assume some weight bounds on the density ratio of the ICR algorithm, and it is known that these conditions are not sufficient for ICR sampler to be V-uniformly geometrically ergodic. But apparently our composition is. So it is an interesting result, but perhaps I'm not sure that I have time to explain more about it. So I will go to pictures. It's quite easy to illustrate how this idea works. For example, on the very toyish setup of the Gaussian mixture. So suppose that you have like well separated like three modes of the three Gaussian modes, yeah? And you want to sample them, for example, with a kind of global sampler, that is ICIR, kind of local sampler, for example, MALA, and our algorithm which combines the two. So in this case, typically, you will observe the same behavior as it is illustrated on the slide. For example, if you use local sampler as MALA, then your algorithm will stuck in one particular mode, and it will never explore. If you use a global sampler, for example, ICIR, it will explore well, but it will spend quite a lot of time in one particular point. So it will also be bad for the variance of the estimate, which is built upon this upon the function values at these points. And at the same time, if you take the combination of the two, then it will reasonably well explore the particular modes, and at the same time, exploit the particular mode, and at the same time, it will explore across the support of the distribution itself. So somehow it combines the benefits of the both approaches. So here are some slides with metrics, so I think that I will skip them. What is also possible is to train the proposal distribution in our shim. For example, it can be done if you parameterize the generative distribution lambda as a push forward of some simple distribution, for example, standard normal, under the mapping which is defined by, for example, a normalizing flow. For example, in our experiments, we use kind of real NVP-based architecture. So we can also prove some convergence results for this shim based on the stochastic approximation techniques. But perhaps I will skip this part and again show you the results that we obtain. For example, there are some classical sampling benchmarks for the distribution with complicated geometry. So this is the so-called banana-shaped distribution. So you can take it in quite large dimension, like 100, 200, something like this. And then it is interesting to compare, for example, the behavior of our algorithm with the behavior of just an algorithm with learned global proposal, so it's like adaptive version of ICIR. And this gives you one more intuition behind why you expect that our algorithm could perform well. So in fact, it's very hard to learn the density of your transformation in the regions where the target density is small. For example, in the tail regions or something like this. And this is what you can observe. So in fact, like the left picture is the one that you have with our algorithm, and the right one is the one that you have without additional local steps. So it is just obtained by sampling something from the same normalizing flow. So you can really see that using this two-step procedure allows you to improve the behavior of your sampler in the tail regions of the target density. And now I will also show you what happens if you take another sampling benchmark. So I will again skip the metrics. So this is a so-called funnel distribution. So it's another quite hard sampling benchmark because why it is hard? Because here half of the mass is concentrated in the very narrow region to the left from the zero. And if you are here, and if you work with some gradient-based method, then you need to do very small steps, because otherwise you will reject all the moves that are suggested by your sampler. At the same time, if you are somewhere to the right of your distribution, then you can do much larger steps. Otherwise, you will not explore the support. So these two are very hard to balance in general. So it's known to be a hard benchmark even for HMC and HMC-based methods. And here we compare our algorithm exactly with the no U-turn sampler, which is one of the modification of HMC with automatically with automatically suggested step size. And once again, so we can observe that with our method, we can nicely learn the tail behavior of the distribution, which is much better than even the one that is predicted by the NUT sampler. And perhaps the last point that I would like to discuss is how to apply all this machinery to improve the sampling from the generative adversarial networks, which are treated as an energy-based network, as an energy-based models. So in general, what is the problem when you work with GAN? So I hope that most of you are familiar with GANs. So, but just as a short reminder, so you have a pair of interacting objects, a generator and a discriminator. So generator learns a transformation typically from low dimensional subspace to large dimensional subspace. Discriminator aims to discriminate between fake objects and the real ones. And typically, after you learn both objects, generator and discriminator, you forget about discriminator. And then you say, like, okay, now for generating new objects, I will use just the generator, and I will simply forget about what I learned for discriminator. Which is perhaps a little bit disappointing, just because discriminator possesses some very useful information about the distribution, and you just reject to use this information. And there is a nice energy-based interpretation of GANs suggested in a recent paper by Chen and other students from Joshua Benjo group, who in fact suggested kind of energy-based interpretation of the GAN. So instead of just sampling from generator, taking the push forward and saying that, okay, now this is our final sample, instead they suggest to sample from some latent space distribution, which is associated with the pair of discriminator and generator. And in fact, this can be done with MCMC. So both the distributions are on the slide, for example, for the Wasserstein GAN and for the classical, like vanilla Jensen-Shannon GAN. In the original paper, the authors proposed to do it with kind of Langevin-based MCMC, which is not super efficient, first of all, due to the issues with multimodal distributions that I discussed in the beginning of the talk. And what we propose to do is to instead use our X2 MCMC and its adaptive version. And what we can show is that, for example, so I will show results on MNIST and on CIFAR 10. For example, even on MNIST, if you take small latent dimension, like dimension 2, and try to use this energy-based machinery, then the problem with MALA and with ICIR can be that MALA tends to stack again in one mode and produce, for example, just, so here it's only nines and zeros, I think, and ICIR tends to stack in a particular example of a number and did not explore. At the same time, with X2 MCMC, you don't have these problems. So here I will also skip, there are some examples for what we can generate on CIFAR 10. So here again, if you look on the chains generated by ICIR, for example, so here in each of this chain, if you look from left to the right, we display each tens sample from each particular run of a certain MCMC algorithm. So if you look at what happens with ICIR, then there are some trajectories when we find quite quickly an appropriate particle, and then we fail to change it for like tens of steps, which is very bad. At the same time, if you look, for example, at what is generated with Mala, then we almost never change the mode. So you start from a particular instance of, for example, a cat or something like this, and then you start to iteratively refine it with respect to some model, but it's very unlikely that you change the mode during the exploration. And if you use, for example, X2MCMC, then you can hope somehow that you can, for example, first you can change the mode, and it's clear that you can do it even after some quite large number of steps. And at the same time, you can somehow improve your mode. You can somehow improve your sample with consecutive graduate steps from Mala, for example. And I will show some metrics, namely the inception score and FID. So they are like standard metrics that people typically display in such type of problems. And so inception score the larger is inception score is the better, the lower is FID, the better. And you can see that in terms of these quality metrics, we also outperform both the baseline algorithms that we somehow improve. So both Mala and ICER. So I think that here I will stop, because for the second part I don't have time. But here I just put a link to the both papers. And okay, so I think that's all for today. So if you have any questions, please.
Thanks for a great talk. What is the main ingredient to avoid mode collapse? Could you repeat this again?
Yeah, so here you have, so again, it's kind of exploration-exploitation trade-off. So here you will still perhaps have mode collapse. Of course, you cannot avoid it completely. But here the idea is that you use two kind of samplers. You use, you interleave kind of global updates that you do, for example, with ICER or some other MCMC, kind of, I don't know, neural transport HMC, something like this, that learns some global distribution, which is easy to generate from, and which allows you to do kind of global moves over the support. So this is your chance to escape from a particular mode. And then once you sampled from this distribution, you do some number of local steps, for example, based on Langevin or something like this, to explore the particular mode. So in some sense, you avoid mode collapse by interleaving the two samplers. Mm-hmm. And apparently, it's interesting that the mixing property of this superposition is somehow better than the mixing properties of just the global sampler alone. Perhaps this is also related, this is something very specific to ICER. So I'm not sure that this phenomena is the same if you will take another global sampler.
Thanks.
Лучше PowerPoint, да? Если кликер работает, лучше PowerPoint. Если не работает.
Смотрим, почему-то Сергей не заработал кликер.
У него, наверное, на его ноуте просто, да, в смысле?
Не знаю, может быть, это.